Yes, a very good morning. I hope all of you are able to hear me. So, how are studies going on? Taking good care of audit? That is what I always keep on asking you, okay? Are you taking good care of the subject? So, all your reasons, no, that no, I have so much work in office, I have so much other things to do, I have so many other places to visit and so many classes to attend and everything. All, you know, the nation has been put, rather the world has been put under a lockdown so that you are able to study. So I hope that actually you are studying, or rather I should ask it as, have you started studying again? Because once you came to know that the exams have gone a bit ahead, you know, your timetable, everything, you would have revamped and so. Right, so just at the beginning, I would like to tell you that right now the lecture, I'm streaming it through Wi-Fi. Sometimes if there is a power failure, that's the only chance. So in that case, the video may get it disconnected, and then I will resume the lecture again once the power starts. But that's only a possibility in case during this 1 hour if there is a power failure. Otherwise, we continue with the lecture. Okay. Right, so 8 days, every day, 1st May to 8th of May, right, 10 to 11 in the morning. There is already a poster which is being given regarding what I will be discussing. Like today and tomorrow, we'll be revising a few questions from the standards on auditing, then ethics, then CARO, right? Then after that, the tax audit, GST audit, and then 2 days for the MCQ, right? The multiple choice questions that we will be discussing. I see a lot of conversation going on in the group. It's after a long time I have got so many good morning wishes. So I really thank you lot for that. I hope the video is playing fine for everyone. Right? It's going fine, okay? Okay, so now I think probably no need to any longer continue to have a look at the chat, and can directly go to our discussion on these standards. Okay, so generally when I'm teaching in a regular class, always the pattern has been that I write down everything, we make notes, I make some charts on my own, and you copy down in your books or so. But this being a revision series, so this time I really wanted to be like, you know, okay, I am taking a revision class. We'll discuss a few important questions which are anticipated or which have been asked in the exams, which are important from the exam viewpoint. Okay. Right, so to begin with, say let's start with essay 210. Right, essay 210, which is regarding the agreeing the terms of audit engagement, talking about the engagement letter. If you see, question asked in the exam from essay 210 has been only one, right? The recurring audit. Right, circumstances when in case of a recurring audit also the auditor is required to send a new engagement letter. You might remember that, you know, there we talk about the 7 changes and 1 misunderstanding. Right, so that is one question which has been asked in the exams. But if you look into the RTP, right, if you have a look into the RTP questions from essay 210, right, you will see one question over there regarding limitation on scope. Right, auditor is saying this is the scope of my audit. Management is saying no, we are going to restrict the scope of your audit. So one question in RTP May 20 and also in RTP November 18 is regarding the circumstances due to which there could be a limitation on the scope of the audit. Then another question which I again see in the RTP over there is regarding the principal contents of the audit engagement letter. If I read the last line over, yes, over there, it says what should be included in the terms of the agreed audit engagement letter. So there they are talking about the principal contents of the audit engagement letter. And the last one, again, RTP November 19, which says that what are the factors which should be considered before accepting refusing the proposal. So before accepting refusing, we have something in 210 called as the, sorry, we have something in 210 called as the preconditions for an audit, or the premise, presumptions, assumptions on which an audit is conducted. Right, so one by one, let us look into each of these questions. I hope everybody is with me. Right, pay attention. Okay, I'm going to, you know, discuss the answer with you. And maybe if you have your textbook, notebook, any chart in front of you, you could just, you know, revise it from there or listen to me very attentively. Okay, I wish that this 1 hour is that there should be some productive, you know, study of the subject of audit. Okay. Right. So coming to the first one, it talks about the limitation on scope, circumstances due to which there is a limitation on the scope of the audit. These circumstances have been divided under three parts. One, it says circumstances which are beyond the control of the entity. Beyond the control of the entity, like say the COVID scenario right now. Right, auditor 31st of March, I think the lockdown had already begun by that time, and auditor said, no, I am a very responsible auditor, I need to go and attend the physical verification count of inventory. No, not possible. It's beyond the control of the entity. Right? So two examples given over there for circumstances which are beyond the control of the entity is one when the accounting records have been destroyed by fire, flood, earthquake or so. And second one over there is when the accounting records have been seized by the governmental authorities. Right? So circumstances which are beyond the control of the entity, what are the examples over there? Right, one where accounting records have been destroyed by fire, flood, earthquake, or second one where the accounting records have been seized by the governmental authorities. Second set of circumstances is relating to the nature of the auditor's work. Right, say for doing the audit of 31st of March 2020, the auditor is appointed on 30th of September 2020. Now, the auditor will be unable to attend the physical inventory count because of the timing of the appointment of the auditor. Right? So, one point regarding the nature of the auditor's work is the timing of the appointment of the auditor. And second one, say auditor says, I want to go for a combined approach of tests of control and substantive procedures. But the tests of controls, the internal controls that the client plays are not there or they are not effective. So now even though if I want to do the control testing, still I'll be unable to do the control testing. Right? So that is relating to the nature of the auditor's work. What are the two points over there? One, the timing of the appointment of the auditor, right? And the second one over there is regarding the right auditor wants to do the testing of the controls, but the controls are not effective as found in previous audit or the audit, there are no controls at all. Right, third set of circumstances over there is due to limitation on scope imposed by the management. And this, you know, we see in two other standards also. Due to limitation on scope imposed by the management. Inventory, all good, no COVID scenario, nothing. But still auditor, management is telling auditor not to attend the physical verification count. Right, so where management is restricting the scope of the audit, okay, but it is due to management imposed limitation not to attend the physical inventory count, right? Or the second one over there, which we study in SA 505, external confirmations, which is regarding management's refusal to allow the auditor to send a confirmation request. You remember that one? Right, group of debtor, group of creditor, client is telling, management is telling auditor not to send a confirmation request. Right, so that's again an example of a limitation on the scope. Right, so we have that one particular important question in RTP May 20 and also in RTP number 18, which is regarding the circumstances limiting the scope of the audit, under which we have three headings: beyond the control of the entity, relating to the nature of the auditor's work, and due to limitation on scope imposed by the management. And for each of them, we have two examples. Is that good for everyone? Okay. Right, I am not having a look at the chat as such because... Okay, still now you're wishing me good morning, okay? Audio is not coming. Scope imposed by... Right, everyone, is the lecture going on fine? Okay. Right, then the second question from SA 210, which I want to discuss with you, is regarding the principal contents of the audit engagement letter. Right, principal contents of audit engagement letter, the objective and scope of the audit regarding why and what are you going to cover in the audit. Second one, the responsibilities of the auditor. Right, the responsibilities of the management, third point over there. The identification of the AFRF, which you assume is going to be used by the management for the preparation of the financial statements, and the anticipated or the expected form and content of the report. right, principal contents of the audit engagement letter. So if you look at that RTP question, it simply says what would be included in the contents of the audit engagement letter. But in the answer provided by the institute, they've only mentioned the principal contents of the engagement letter. So same expected from us also, that we write down the principal contents. What are the principal contents? Objective and scope. Responsibilities of the auditor, responsibilities of the management, the identification of the AFRF and the expected form and content of the report. Right, third one, a very important question again from SA210 is regarding the preconditions from an audit. This is like what I call it as the R raised to 10 and read revised 10 times before the exam and the waiting list question, WLQ, those types. Okay, preconditions, premise, presumptions, assumptions on which an audit is conducted. Right, so first main precondition. So total we have six preconditions. Those of you who might have studied SA210 before would be able to recollect what I'm saying. Right, preconditions for an audit divided under six. One, the main precondition. And once this main precondition is fulfilled, then we have five other preconditions. Right, what is the first main precondition for an audit? The acceptability of the AFRF. That the AFRF with the applicable financial reporting framework, which is going to be used by the management in the preparation of the financial statements, is that acceptable to the auditor? Because if management is going to prepare financial statements as per Australian GAAP and that they expect that the auditor will express an opinion true and fair for Australian GAAP financial statements, that's not going to happen. Right, so the acceptability of the AFRF, that whether the AFRF which is being used by the management in the preparation of the financial statements, is that acceptable to the auditor? And once the AFRF is acceptable, then auditor says, I have five more preconditions. Right, five more preconditions. What are those? One, the preparation and a presentation of the financial statements in accordance with the AFRF. Whose responsibility? Management, your responsibility. Then, design, implementation and maintenance of internal financial controls, right, in order to prevent, detect fraud and error. Whose responsibility? Management, your responsibility. Right, so preparation, presentation of financial statements, design, implementation, maintenance of internal control. Whose responsibility? Management, your responsibility. Then, to provide the auditor with three things. What are the three things? All information of which the management is aware, which could be required by the auditor during the course of the audit. That these are the litigations which took place during the year. These are the subsequent events. These are our related parties. These are the laws and regulations we need to comply. These are the ones we've not complied. Covering all information to the auditor of which the management is aware. Then any additional information which the auditor may require from management TCWG. Right, so right now all the auditors, you know, they are having a discussion, updating their audit strategy, updating their audit plan considering the COVID scenario. They are identifying and assessing new risks of material misstatement. Whatever SR, significant risk they had identified earlier, now there is a change in those risks. Then they are also asking management, management, what steps are you taking? Give us additional information. Like I just read, I know WhatsApp, so you've done like a full course on Corona by now. So much of knowledge. So one I saw over there on a mug, you know, it was written EBITDAC. So that is earnings before interest, depreciation, amortization and coronavirus. Okay, right. So it's generally EBITDA, now it is EBITAC. So also coronavirus also over there. Right, so anyways, any additional information which the auditor could require from the management TCWG. Right, and the last point over there, unrestricted access to persons within the entity from whom the auditor considers it necessary to obtain the audit evidence. Right, what are these? These are the preconditions for an audit. And 1 plus 5. What is the one precondition? The acceptability of the AFRF. And once the AFRF is acceptable, 5 more. Preparation and presentation of financial statements in accordance with AFRF, management, your responsibility. Design, implementation, maintenance of internal control, management, your responsibility. And then three more responsibilities: to provide the auditor with all information of which the management is aware, any additional information which the auditor could require from management TCWG, and unrestricted access to persons within the entity. Right, so three important questions from SE210 which I wanted to discuss with you, right? What was regarding the circumstances limiting the scope of the audit, then the preconditions for an audit, and the principal contents of the audit engagement letter. Right, then after that, if I go to say SA230, which is regarding the audit documentation, right, there is one question which has again come in the RTP from there. The factors affecting the form, content, and extent of audit documentation. I think November 15 previously this question has been asked, saying as factors influencing the amount of working papers. So technically in the standard, the question is given as factors affecting the form, content, and the extent of audit documentation. Yes, everybody with me? Right? Wavelength, radio frequency, and 98.3, and the wavelength has to match. Very important. Okay, otherwise, see, I have decided that I want to take a revision series, so I'm taking it. But if you are not able to understand or grasp it, then again your time will get wasted, and I don't want that to happen in any case. Okay, right. So I'm talking about SA230, the factors affecting the form, the content, and the extent of audit documentation. Means I'm talking about the factors influencing the amount of working papers, factors affecting the file size. When will your audit file become bigger? When will it become fatter? When will it become thicker? Bigger audit file. Obviously, my audit file will be bigger when my client is big. So obvious, no? Right, so the size and complexity of the entity. Are you getting the question first? Right, factors affecting the form, content, and extent of audit documentation. What are the factors? First factor, the size and complexity of the entity. Second one, the RMM identified. Right, risks of material misstatement. Right, so the RMM identified. The more the RMM identified, the more the documentation will increase. Right, so the RMM identified, the exceptions identified, right, the more the exceptions identified, the more the material misstatements identified in the audit, the more the documentation I'll have to maintain in my audit file, right, so the exceptions identified. Then the audit procedures performed, right, so how much nature, timing, and extent of audit procedures. Are you doing TOC this year, or are you going to rely on the testing of controls done in the previous audit? Right, whether you're going to go for more of test of details or more of substantive analytical procedures. Right, so the audit procedures performed, that is also going to affect my audit file. See, after every point which you write in the answer, you have to keep a track of what is the question. Big possibility of you going off track, because you know sometimes your target is not to write an answer, your target is to fill the page. I'm not talking about any one person individually. Everybody is saying, oh, madam is telling about me. It's just a coincidence that it happens to be about you. But I'm just making a general comment over here. Okay, right. So the audit procedures performed, the audit evidence obtained. Okay, so obviously the more the evidence, more persuasive audit evidence, more extensive audit evidence, more number of samples to be checked, it will increase my audit file size. And if it is a box file, then instead of one box file, now I'll have two box files. Right, if it is a soft file, instead of 1 GB file, now I may have a 2 GB file. So much of documentation I would have kept. Right, so the audit evidence obtained, the conclusions reached. Right, conclusions reached over here, say in case if I'm reaching an adverse opinion, not a true and fair. Obviously, I'll have to keep a fair amount of documentation giving an evidence as to why am I expressing an adverse opinion. Disclaimer, my file would be as good as empty, because I have not been able to obtain the sufficient appropriate audit evidence only. Right, so what is the heading? Factors affecting the form, content, and extent of audit documentation. What are the factors? The size and complexity of the entity, the RMM identified, the exceptions identified, the audit procedures performed, the audit evidence obtained, the conclusions reached, and the last one over there, the audit methodology and the tools used. Right, so depending upon whether the auditor is doing the checking manually or whether he is doing the testing with the help of the CATS, the computer assisted audit techniques, or now in your chapter of automated environment that is referred to as data analytics. You know, the process of generating meaningful information from raw system data using processes, tools, and techniques is known as data analytics. know, so when the audit methodology and the tools used, right? So that was also a factor affecting the form content and extent of audit documentation. Right, so that's one question which I thought I should take from SA 230. Right, then if I come to SA 240, right, everybody with me? Right, paying attention? Okay, right, SA 240, the auditor's responsibilities relating to fraud in an audit of financial statements. Right, two types of fraud discussed in SA 240. What are those two? Right, fraudulent financial reporting and the misappropriation of assets. So one, either you do a fraud in accounting, or second, you do a fraud in the assets of the company, like embezzling receipts, inflating payments, suppressing receipts, right? That is misappropriation of inventory, the intangible assets of the company, misappropriation of assets. And another type of fraud, fraudulent financial reporting. Accounting records, there is a fraud. Accounting, accounting policies, there is a fraud. Accounting estimates, there is a fraud. Accounting entry, there is a fraud. Right? So all types of fraud being done in accounting, type of, you know, I could say a window dressing. Right? Manipulating the books of account of the company, either to, you know, not declare dividend, or to avoid the burden of taxes, or to maintain the share price of the company, right? Whatever could be the reason. So fraudulent financial reporting and misappropriation of assets. Right? Two reportings for fraud required. One under section 143(12) of the Companies Act 2013, duty to report fraud to CG. Fraud 1 crore or above, you report to central government, obviously after first reporting to audit committee, board of director, their reply, observation, then to CJ. And if it is less than 1 crore, then only to the audit committee, board of director, and also a disclosure in the board report. And we also have a reporting requirement under CARO, right? Clause 10 of CARO 2016, which is regarding the fraud. Okay, I'm getting a lot of mails where students are asking, you know, ma'am, CARO 2020, when it will be applicable, like how will I come to know? Now, honestly speaking, at this point of time, even I am not in a position to tell you which attempt it will become applicable. So May 20, June 20, July, whenever the next exam, for that certainly it is not applicable. That is the truth. That is a fact. Right, for November 20, I think let's wait and watch. Okay, but if you see all the 16 clauses which are there in CARO 2016, out of that 15 are there in CARO 2020 with obviously a lot of alterations and mainly additions. So studying CARO 2016, it's not like, you know, it is just CARO 2020 is a higher version of CARO 2016. Right, so those of you who in your material, in your video lectures right now are having CARO 2016, please study from that. Later on, whenever the CARO 2020 becomes applicable for your exams, I'll be covering it in the amendment video on YouTube. Right, I think that is fair enough. Okay, right, some of you are facing a problem right now that we are not getting the physical copy of the books, you know, due to this corona lockdown and scenario, courier services not available. Right, so I think you're not able to do the marking or so, and some problem. Now that is a reality which cannot be changed, right? We staying back at home for more than a month. You could have never imagined doing that, but we have under such situations that we have to do that. Right, so similarly, what I would suggest, like for the time being, you may download the ICI module. Right, and then obviously that's a database on the basis of which all the books, at least the audit book of, you know, from which I teach is being prepared. So at least, you know, nothing in front of you, at least you would be having that copy in front of you, and then you can do some marking, or, you know, as a reference book you can use it. Okay, right, so anyways, we are talking about SA 240, right? Everybody with me? Right? Everybody listening to me? Okay, right. So SA 240, the auditor's responsibilities relating to fraud in an audit of financial statements. Very important, like, you know, whenever a case study regarding fraud is asked in the exam, right? What are the responsibilities of the auditor? Like, you've been studying it since your intermediate days, that detection of frauds and errors. Is it the primary responsibility of the auditor? No. Right, so primary responsibility for prevention, detection of fraud and error rests with the management. Auditor's objective is only to obtain a, you know that since childhood, no? Reasonable assurance that financial statements are free from material misstatement, whether due to fraud or error, thereby enabling the auditor to express an opinion that financial statements have been prepared by the management in accordance with an applicable financial reporting framework, and then to report the findings of the auditor in accordance with the standards on auditing, right? That's the overall objective given in SA 200. Right, so primary responsibility for prevention, detection of fraud and error, management, your responsibility. Auditor's objective is to obtain a reasonable assurance. Then what does auditor say? Fraud is more difficult to detect than an error, right? Because fraud is intentional, sophisticated, intentionally, carefully organized schemes designed to conceal it. Right, so fraud more difficult to detect than an error. Management fraud more difficult to detect than an employee fraud. Right, and then after that we talk about 143.12 and clause 10. And if as a result, this last point part which I'm discussing right now is very important. Huh? We've seen like many of the case studies where you found that some bogus journal entry has been passed towards the year end, near the year end. And so that we give an example over there of recording fictitious journal entry and a bogus journal entry when particularly close to the end of an accounting period. Not in the month of September or August, but in the month of February or March, particularly close to the year, near the year end. Why? To manipulate operating results or to achieve other objectives. What I'm saying, say they are providing, you know, making some provision entries in the books of account on 28th of March or something. Right, so what is that? Recording fictitious journal entry when particularly close to the year end, near the year end. Why? To manipulate operating results or to achieve other objectives. Okay, right, so when such type of case studies where you think that there is a fraud or you conclude that there is a fraud, then in the end part of your answer, this is what is expected to be written. Right, if as a result of fraud or suspected fraud, are you all with me? Pay attention, right? This, so you keep it in your mind right now. So in the exam hall, if a question on fraud comes, you try to remember, you know, what I had told you in the class, and then you just write down. Okay, if as a result of fraud or suspected fraud, the auditor encounters exceptional circumstances that bring into question the auditor's ability to continue performing the audit. Are you getting the wording? Right? This is what is very important. You can't write in your own words in an audit paper. If as a result of fraud or suspected fraud, the auditor encounters exceptional circumstances that bring into question the auditor's ability to continue performing the audit, one, he should determine the professional legal responsibilities as applicable in the circumstances. Now, nowadays, one of the professional legal responsibility which we have is that we have to report it to the central government if it is 1 crore or above. Do you understand that? And also, we have to do our audit in accordance with the standards on auditing. So, obviously, if I come to know about a fraud, that is a material misstatement, accordingly, I should modify my opinion and I should not issue an unmodified opinion. Right, so as a result of fraud, what are you going to check? Determine the professional legal responsibilities applicable in the circumstances. And once you've considered your legal professional responsibilities, second, check whether now it is considered whether it is necessary to withdraw from the engagement. Why? Otherwise, you will also fall into trouble. You may also fall into suit. Right, why? Because there is a fraud which has been identified, or you suspect that there is a fraud. So rather than you going into those bad waters, better you withdraw from the engagement right away. Right? So consider whether it is appropriate to withdraw from the engagement. If withdrawal is legally permissible, right? If law regulation does not bind you to complete the engagement. And if you withdraw, auditor says, okay, I think that there is a fraud, so better I resignation of company auditor. No, withdraw means what? Resignation, 140 subsection 2. The reasons for withdrawal are to be communicated to management TCWG. Right. So once again, let me put it together. If as a result of fraud or suspected fraud, the auditor encounters exceptional circumstances that bring into question the auditor's ability to continue performing the audit, determine the professional legal responsibilities, and also consider whether it is appropriate to withdraw from the engagement. And if he withdraws, reasons for withdrawal to be communicated to TCWG. Right? Good for everyone, right? The important case study from SA 240, the auditor's responsibilities relating to fraud in an audit of financial statements. Okay. Right. Then another standard, say, which I go to, say, let me go to SA 299. Right, 299, joint audit of financial statements. Sometime back it was called as responsibility of joint auditors. Okay, now what is it? The standard has been revised to be called as, right, joint audit of the financial statements. One question from this revised standard, which I am waiting for it to be asked in the exams. Right, which I am waiting for it to be asked in the exams is regarding the factors to be considered in the development of the joint audit plan, right? Awaited, WLQ, right? Waiting list question, right? R raised to 10, right? Read revise 10 times before the exam. Then students say, madam, then immediately you'll do marking in your book, R raised to 10, WLQ. And then you say, what if it doesn't come in the exam? Doesn't come. That's it. There's nothing more to it. There's no more. Whatever analysis was possible, we've done. Now, once whether it is asked or not asked, then the question of analysis stops over there. Okay. Right. Factors to be considered in the development of the joint audit plan. So I'll be so happy if all of those of you who are seeing this video have realized that 240 ka jo case study ma'am discussed kar rahe the, hai na, that 240 whatever case study I was discussing, that discussion is over and now she has gone to the next standard, SA 299, and she's already told us the heading called as the factors to be considered in the development of the joint audit plan. I'm very happy in case if you are aware about it. Okay, right, joint audit plan, right, 300 we talk about, you know, 300 planning an audit of financial statements. There we talk about the factors to be considered in the development of the overall audit plan, the overall audit strategy. Here I'm talking about the joint audit plan. Right, so first point in the joint audit plan, it says the joint auditors shall by mutual discussion, are you all with me? Right, the joint auditor shall by mutual discussion amongst themselves, aapas mein, will decide upon the division of audit areas and also the common audit areas. Right, so first point and the factors to be considered in the development of the joint audit plan is what? The joint auditor shall by mutual discussion decide upon the division of audit areas and also the common audit areas. Right, now they are preparing a joint audit plan. So, mil jul ke unhe audit karna hai. Right, so obviously another factor which they should consider while preparing the joint audit plan is that the reporting objective. Right, why? What is the objective of this audit? Right, so again, reasonable assurance, SA 200. Right, what is the scope of the audit? Right, so reporting objectives and the scope. Right, third one. You know, in SA 300, it talks about that auditor, before you prepare an audit plan, you need to do some preliminary engagement activities, right? You know, acceptance, continuance of client relationship in accordance with SQC 1, SA 220, issuing engagement letter to client in accordance with SA 210, ensuring whether you can comply with the ethical requirements, including independence. Okay, this lecture, little bit, it might be an overdose for somebody who has not studied standards at all or who had studied standards a long time ago, because you know this time I had an intent that when I take a revision series I actually wanted to be a revision series, right? So no problem, at least sometime you're hearing it for the first time, we can put it that way, right? So SA 300 requires, you know, that before you prepare an audit plan you need to do some preliminary work. And that preliminary work may give you some inputs regarding points which you should consider while preparing the audit plan. Are you understanding? Hena, that preliminary work may give you some inputs regarding the factors you should consider while preparing an audit plan. Right. So the third factor which you need to consider again in the joint audit plan is the results of the preliminary engagement activities. Right. So some inputs from the preliminary engagement activities. Right, then fourth one, yes, no donkey work, no monkey work you should do, no donkey work, smart work, intelligent work. Right, so it says the professional judgment as to which areas significant effort is going to be required to be put by the members of the engagement team. Right, so you know this year the client has come up with an IPO, right, an initial public offer or a FPO, further public offer. Right, so now you know this year share capital checking is going to be vast. Or this year, a lot of capitalization of plant and machinery has taken place. So, you know, this year, fixed assets, you know, property, plant, and equipment, the checking has to be more. This we also see when we have to determine key audit matters in SA 701. Okay, right. So, what is the fourth point I'm telling you? Professional judgment as to which area significant effort is required to be put by the members of the engagement team. So they know, okay, inventory, we'll have to do more checking, share capital, more checking, property, plant, equipment, more checking. Factor to be considered in development of joint audit plan. Right, then the next point over there, the nature, timing, and the extent of the resources required to perform the engagement. Right, so nature, timing, and the extent of resources. How many articles, how many first year qualified CAs, how many managers on the assignment, how many team seniors on the assignment, how many days they would be required, right? How, what areas they should specialize in. So nature, timing, and extent of not audit procedure, resources required to perform the engagement. Right, and then one, each joint auditor will assess the RMM for the area which has been divided to him, and then accordingly they will communicate the RMM identified by each of the joint auditor and accordingly prepare the joint audit plan. Okay, right, so what is the question which I wanted to discuss with you? The factors to be considered in the development of the joint audit plan. What are the factors? One, the joint auditor shall by what? The joint auditor shall by mutual discussion, very good, decide upon the division of audit areas and also the common audit areas, right? That is point number one. Point number two, right, the reporting objectives and the scope of the engagement that you should consider while preparing a joint audit plan. Third one, yes, tell me the third one. The results of the preliminary engagement activities which you need to do before you prepare an audit plan. So that might also give you some inputs. Right, then next one, I told you no donkey work. And a professional judgment as to which areas significant effort would be required to be put by the members of the engagement team. Then next one, the nature, timing, and extent of the resources required to perform the engagement, right? The nature, timing, and the extent of the resources required to perform the engagement. And the last one I told you, each joint auditor will identify and assess the RMM related to the work divided, relating to the work allotted to them, and then they will communicate this to all the other joint auditors, and they accordingly they will prepare a joint audit plan. Okay, right. Another question from 299, which I want to discuss with you, which is an ATF in our audit class terminology, if you've done the class. ATF stands for an all-time favorite, right? Near and dear to ICAI, one of the very favorite question of the institute over there, which is regarding the areas where the joint auditors are jointly and severally responsible. Right, areas where the joint audit, oh wow, in the WhatsApp, in the YouTube chat, you know, they are putting all the points regarding the joint audit plan. So I don't, like, obviously I can't mind it, means I have no control over it. You can type whatever is to be typed in the chat box, but your focus has to be on attention. That is what I can tell you. So whatever works best for you, accordingly you can decide. Right. So now talking about the areas where the joint auditors are going to be jointly and severally responsible. So we know, you know, for work which is divided, who is going to be responsible? The respective joint auditor to whom that work has been allocated. And what are the areas where the joint auditors are going to be jointly and severally responsible? Right? One, for work which is not divided, obviously. You know, what are the areas where the joint auditors are going to be jointly and severally responsible? One, where for work which is not divided. Second one, it talks about deciding upon the nature, timing, and extent of the audit procedures for the common audit areas. Execution will be the responsibility of the respective joint auditor. Only deciding upon, because it is common audit area, no, it is not divided audit area. So deciding upon the nature, timing, and extent of the audit procedures for the common audit areas, again, jointly and severally responsible. Then third one, matter relating to all the joint auditors, say Schedule 3 compliance, accounting standard compliance, any such matter. you know, some big litigation going on. Okay, so matter relating to all the joint auditors brought to the attention by any one of the joint auditors. Again, how they are going to be responsible? They are going to be jointly and severally responsible. Right, third one, whether the financial statements comply with the requirements of the AFRF to check. You know, whether the financial statements comply with the requirements of the legal statutory AFRF requirements. Whether presentation and disclosure of financial statements is in accordance with the AFRF. Right? So that is again whether Schedule 3 compliances have been given to check that okay, whether presentation and disclosure is as per AFRF. Whose responsibility? Everybody's responsibility. All joint auditors' responsibility. That is the heading we are discussing. No, jointly and severally responsible. Right. And the last one over there, the audit report to be issued, whether it is in compliance with the standards and also the other relevant pronouncements of ICAI. Right. So what is the question I just discussed with you right now? The areas where the joint auditors are going to be jointly and severally responsible. Right. So what are the 6 points where they are going to be jointly and severally responsible? One, work which is not divided. Second one, deciding upon the nature, timing and extent of the audit procedures for the common audit areas. Third one, matter relating to all the joint auditors but brought to the attention by any one of the joint auditors. Right? Then whether the financial statements comply with the statutory legal regulatory requirements, whether presentation and disclosure of financial statements is in accordance with the AFRF, and the audit report to be issued, is it in accordance with the standards and the other relevant pronouncements of ICAI? Right, so that is two questions from SA 299. First question was the factors to be considered in the development of the joint audit plan. And the second question over there was regarding the areas where the joint auditors are going to be jointly and severally responsible. So any case study, any direct indirect question asked from SA 299 from the exam, these points regarding the jointly and severally responsible are always coming in the answers. So very important, I would recommend that you can also do the writing practice, right? Knowing the content, understanding the content, knowing the points for it is half the battle won, right? Able to convert it on paper, you know, able to write it in black and white or blue and white, you know, on a paper, converting it into a sentence, okay, that art is also required to be developed. Right, so just knowing and just remembering points, yes, that is the first step. But then it's not complete. You need to go for the next step also. That is, you have to do the writing practice. Okay, right. So that is 299. Students are putting on the group, ma'am, 220, ma'am, some other standard. So anyways, I have decided a few questions which I will discuss with you. So whatever best possible, I will discuss with you. Okay, so they are mentioning, okay, vitamin W has immediately come out. That's good. Okay. Okay, that's the USP, no, of you, only those who've done the class would know what is vitamin W. Okay, otherwise it's, you know, some students, they might go to a medical store asking ke bhaiya vitamin W ka medicine hai kya aapke paas, to bolenge nahi, wo sirf audit ke class mein milta hai aur kahin nahi milta hai. Okay, right, if you go to any medical and ask that do you have vitamin W medicines, that medical fellow will tell you that you don't get it in a medical, that you only get it in the audit class. Okay, so any one of you doing it from South India, okay, I generally happen to repeat whatever I speak in Hindi also in English. Right. Another question, say, which I would like to take up right now with you is regarding SA 505. Right, tomorrow's day also, we have also kept it for the standards only. So few more questions, I'll take them tomorrow also. Right, SA 505, which is regarding the external confirmations, right, a direct written response to the auditor from a third party. Okay, students, I don't know, somehow I can do a mind read. You say, right now she was discussing 299, how come all of a sudden she went to 505? At least I went from one standard to another. In exam, though, what happens after standard on auditing, next question is on NBFC and next question is on tax audit and next one is on CARO. So there you can't tell, no, that how come you asked, you should ask in sequence, there has to be some discipline. No. It is going to be random selection, so you have to be ready for that. Okay, right. So SA 505, which is regarding the external confirmations, a direct written response to the auditor from a third party. Okay, right now in the COVID scenario, when the auditors are doing the audit for the year ended 31st March 2020, okay, no courier service, no going to the bank and saying, bank, please confirm Jio Limited or any company, you know, Tata Motors, how much bank balance in their account, right? So now they have an app for that, no, called as iResponse. Okay, so the auditor on the app, he will send directly a confirmation request to the bank. So earlier, say it could happen on email also, but now they have developed a separate app itself for it. Right, so iResponse, the auditor directly sends the information to the bankers of the client and the bankers directly confirm the amount on the app and then it gets documented in the audit file. So I think very soon our standard on auditing should also be revised to incorporate this app being used for the confirmations from the third parties. Okay. Anyways, right, so external confirmations. One question which is very important over there is regarding the positive confirmation request and the negative confirmation request. I hope you are listening with both your ears open. Right, the positive confirmation request and the negative confirmation request. Right, who sends the confirmation request? The auditor sends it to the third party. Okay, so now positive confirmation request, whether the confirming party agrees or whether the confirming party disagrees with whatever information has been mentioned in the confirmation request. In both cases, it has to reply. That is the example of a positive confirmation request. Right, a negative confirmation request, the confirming party is required to send a reply to the auditor only if it disagrees. Right, positive confirmation request. So now positive agrees or disagrees. Negative only if it disagrees. Right, positive confirmation request, whether agrees or disagrees, in both cases it needs to reply. So if auditor has asked that please confirm the amount of 1000 crore, so bank agrees, yes, there is a bank balance of 1000 crore, or bank disagrees, it says what they are saying 1000 crore, not even 20 crore balance. Whatever it is, in both cases the third party has to reply. That's an example of a positive confirmation request. Okay, now what is the risk in using positive confirmations? One very, what do you say, a very big risk identified in case of positive confirmations is that the confirmation, the third party, the intended respondent may reply to the confirmation request without verifying. So you said please confirm the amount of 1000 crore. They signed and they send it back to the auditor. Auditor gala, happy. You know what, yes, third party has confirmed, but they might have confirmed without verifying. So that's a risk that the confirming party may reply to the confirmation request without verifying the information. That is one risk. I'm talking about positive confirmations right now. Then, in order to mitigate this risk, in order to reduce, cover this risk, the auditor may consider sending the positive confirmation request, which are the blank confirmation request, open, where the amount is not mentioned. Okay, what risk he found? That if I mention the amount, if it's a closed confirmation request, there is a risk that the third party may reply without verifying. So what he decides, let me send a blank confirmation request. But the standard says there also we've identified a risk. What risk have you identified over there? That now it may lead to a lower response rate of the third party because additional effort is required on the part of the third party to confirm the balance. Now please confirm the amount as per your books. Now they say I'll have to open my books and then mention some amount, and by mistake also if that amount is not right, it will all come on to me. So I have to be very sure if I have to mention the amount. So he says, who will take the effort? Better I don't reply only. Right, so that's one question which has been asked in the exams regarding the effect of using positive confirmations. So you have to say it's a double-edged sword. If I send closed also, where I mention the amount, there is a risk that they may reply without verifying. Then I don't mention the amount, then there is a risk that it may lead to a lower response rate because additional effort is required on the part of the confirming party. Right, clear to everyone? Right, another favorite question, which is again there in RTP May 20, I think that's the first question in the RTP May 20. Management's refusal to allow the auditor to send a confirmation request. We discussed this heading in SA 210 also, no? Limitation on scope imposed by the management. Management is telling auditor, we have 1000 debtors. Out of these 1000 debtors, any debtor you want to send a confirmation request, you may send except for these 5 debtors. These 5 debtors, auditor not to send a confirmation request. Debtor, I'm just giving it as an example. So what is it? Management's refusal to allow the auditor to send a confirmation request. Right? What are the points which you will write in your answer? Everybody with me? Yes, are you paying attention? Are you looking at the clock? Okay, right. Management's refusal to allow the auditor to send a confirmation request. Right, first one, ask the reasons to the management. Right, ask the reasons to the management. Right, then inquire as to the validity and the reasonableness of the reasons given by the management. Right, so ask the reasons to the management, then check the validity and the reasonableness of the reasons given by the management. Then consider the impact of the management's refusal. See, what is the situation? Management is telling auditor 5 debtors not to send confirmation request. One, you ask what is the reason? And why not to send a confirmation request to these 5 debtors? That is one. Now second, they are telling me not to send a confirmation request to these 5 debtors. So now the auditor will assess the impact of the management's refusal on the auditor's assessment of RMM. Is there any risk in debtors? Is there any risk in credit sale? In my example, because I'm talking about debtors. Right? The auditor will assess the impact of the management's refusal on the auditor's assessment of RMM, including the risk of fraud, okay, whether there is any fraud, and the nature, timing, and extent of the other audit procedures. Right? So you're considering the impact of the management's refusal. Right, third one, you're also a sensible auditor. You are skeptical also and you're sensible also. So because you were skeptical, you considered, let me check the impact of management's refusal. And now you're sensible also. So that don't write an examiner because he's a sensible auditor, because he's a skeptical auditor. That I'm just telling to explain it to you. Right, because he is sensible, he would also say, let me perform some alternative audit procedures, some other audit procedures to obtain the sufficient appropriate audit evidence. And if not by hook, by crook. It's not that I have to get the evidence through confirmation, I can get it through some other means also. So perform alternative audit procedures to obtain the sufficient appropriate audit evidence. Let me first take these 3 points again with you. What was the first point I told you? Right, inquire. Right, ask reasons to the management as to why you are not allowing, the reasons for the management's refusal. Also check for the validity and the reasonableness of the reasons given by the management. Right, then second one, the impact of the management's refusal on the auditor's assessment of RMM, including the risk of fraud and the nature, timing, and extent of the other audit procedures. Is that clear? And third one, perform alternative audit procedures to obtain the sufficient appropriate audit evidence. Right? Perform the alternative audit procedures. Okay, then if auditor after doing these 3 procedures concludes what? That one, reasons of management's refusal are unreasonable. What reason they are saying? He's gone out of station. He is affected by corona, so you better don't go to him. Any such reason. That could be actually a valid reason, but just telling, right, that they are telling that management's reasons for refusal are unreasonable. Or even by performing the alternative audit procedures, you are unable to obtain the sufficient appropriate audit evidence. Right? Finally, auditor may conclude that this constitutes a limitation on scope. Due to a limitation on scope, he will be unable to obtain the sufficient appropriate audit evidence. And depending upon the pervasiveness, the auditor may modify his opinion, issuing a qualified opinion or a disclaimer of opinion as may be appropriate. Right? As may be appropriate. Right? So that is essay 505. 2 questions I discussed with you over there. One, the effect of using the positive confirmations. Right? There's also one separate discussion in that standard which you will see regarding negative confirmations and situations where negative confirmations may be used. And another question over there, which is regarding the management's refusal to allow the auditor to send a confirmation request. Okay, one more, say, let me take, that question is not yet asked and they put it in the RTP. So there is no other great analysis that I have. It's just an observation I can say. Essay 501. What is 501? Right, what is... Right, essay 501, audit evidence specific consideration for selected items. What are the 3 selected items over there? Right, existence and condition of. See, even though if I am not able to hear your tablet, your laptop, your mobile on whatever you're seeing, at least that should be able to hear, no? Huh? Existence and condition of inventory. Then completeness of litigations and claims. And the third one, the presentation and disclosure of the segment information. Right? So existence and condition of inventory. Right? Existence. Okay, client is saying we are having so much of inventory in stock. Auditor wants to check, obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence whether really does that inventory exist. Again, our RTP May 20 question. Right? Existence and condition of inventory. What audit procedure the auditor should perform? The auditor shall, yes, the auditor, he wants to check what client is telling we have so much of inventory, whether the inventory really exists. The auditor shall attend the physical verification count being conducted by the management, because physical verification of inventory, whose responsibility? Management's responsibility. Right? So attend the physical verification count being conducted by the management at the year end date, 31st March, unless impracticable. Right, unless impracticable. And now when you go to the go down to attend the physical inventory count, what are the procedures you're going to perform? You're going to observe the count procedures, you're going to inspect the inventory, you're going to re-perform test counts, you're going to evaluate management's instructions, whether management's physical verification policy guidelines, whether those are being followed or not. Are you understanding? Right? Then reconcile with the actual inventory records. So inventory register, how much? Physical stock, how much? What you have in CARU also, na? Material discrepancies noticed on physical verification. Right? So how to obtain evidence for the physical verification, for the existence and condition of inventory? You attend the physical verification count being conducted by the management at the year-end date, unless impracticable. Not possible on year-end date? Okay, try to attend on an alternative date. Again, alternative date, you perform the same procedures, right? Alternative date, again, you perform the same procedures, right? And additionally, you will check for the intervening transaction. So if say you attended it on 28th of March, then now you'll have to check additionally the transaction between 28th of March to 31st of March. Or say you attended it on 3rd of April. So now you'll have to additionally check the transactions between 1st April to 3rd April, right? So additionally, check for the intervening transaction. Third possibility, year end also not possible. That was first one, attend on year end date. If not year end date, second we said attend on alternative date. You are saying alternative date is also not possible. Now third procedure, perform alternative audit procedures to obtain the sufficient appropriate audit evidence. And perform the alternative audit procedures to obtain the sufficient appropriate audit evidence. Still unable to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence, you perform alternative procedures, still not able to attend, then what to do? Right? SA 705, modifications to the opinion in the independent auditor's report. It will lead to a qualified opinion or a disclaimer of opinion. Okay. Right. This is regarding the audit procedures for inventory of the client, which is lying with the client. Right. Second, it could be inventory of the client, which is lying with the third party. Right, inventory of the client, but it is lying with the third party. Again, this is an awaited question. Okay, inventory lying with third party. Now here, what is the first procedure? For inventory lying with the client, what was the first procedure? Attend the physical verification count at year-end date. Now I'm talking about inventory at the year-end date, which is lying with the third party, or inventory as on the, if you want to check the existence and condition of inventory lying with the third party. What is procedure number one? Obtain the confirmation from the third party. Right? Obtain the confirmation from the third party. Are you all with me? Right? Important question I'm discussing. Right? Audit procedures to obtain evidence regarding the existence and condition of inventory lying with the third party. Right? Procedure number one. Right? Obtain the confirmation from the third party. If not, you go and perform the inspection of the inventory lying with the third party. Right, so auditor himself, he may go and attend, perform the inspection of the inventory lying with the third party. Auditor cannot go, say it's in a different geographical location or due to any other reasons, time constraints or so. Right, he can arrange for another auditor to go and attend the physical verification of inventory being conducted at the third party. Right, then you can also obtain the third party auditor's report, the service auditor's report, the internal auditor's report, right? Third party auditor report. Because their auditor would have excluded it from their stock, because my client is saying that it is our inventory which is lying with the third party. Right, so you can obtain the third party auditor's report. Right, then you can also inspect the documentation. Because when goods are being sent by client to third party, then subsequently they would be received back, you know, sometimes for job processing, some work and assembly work, it is sent to third party or just kept in the third party godown for storage or something like in a godown or so. Right, so inspect the documentation regarding the movement of the goods between the client and the third party. And again, where inventory has been given as a collateral, you can obtain a confirmation from the third party. Right, so inventory lying with the third party. Right, what are the audit procedures for inventory lying with third party? Obtain a confirmation from the third party. Right, another. Right, you go and perform the inspection of the inventory lying with the third party. Or arrange for another auditor. Is it right? Right, or obtain the third party auditor's report, service auditor's report, because their auditor should have excluded it from the stock of the third party. Right, then inspect the documentation regarding the movement of the goods. Right, and again, where inventory has been given as a collateral, again, you can obtain a confirmation from the third party. Right, so what did we discuss in this particular session today? I think 210, engagement letter, agreeing the terms of audit engagement. Then we saw one question from 230, factors affecting the form, content and extent of audit documentation. Then 240, fraud, whose responsibility, auditor ka responsibility hai, management ka hai, main hai, additional hai, kya hai? And the auditor's responsibilities relating to fraud in an audit of financial statements. Right, then we also discussed this 299, right, which is in which we studied regarding the joint audit plan. Right, and also regarding the areas where the joint auditors are jointly and severally responsible. Then 505, that is regarding the external confirmations, questions over there. And also 501, which is regarding the audit evidence specific consideration for selected items, in which we studied regarding audit procedures for existence and condition of inventory lying with the client and which is lying with the third party. Right, so we'll continue with our session for the revision of the standards on auditing tomorrow. Right, so the sessions as such, they continue up to 8th of May. So tomorrow is for standards, and then we have some other topics also to be discussed. Right, thank you so much.